Have you ever heard of Rapa Nui? You may know it by another name. Some 3,500 kilometers west of Chile, Easter Island is famous for its 887 Moai statues that pepper a curiously barren landscape. This once thriving island used to be home to 15,000 people, supported by lush vegetation. But in the course of just a century, that shrank to 3,000 inhabitants living in a virtually treeless landscape where denuded soils then suffered terrible erosion and a catastrophic loss of soil nutrients. Simply put, the soil and its ability to sustain food production for a growing population collapsed. That may sound pretty bad, but what if I were to tell you that we're doing much of the same thing globally right now, disrupting soils planet-wide and sending billions of tons of carbon out into the atmosphere? That emitted soil carbon already accounts for nearly a quarter of all human-made greenhouse gas emissions. Despite that loss, more carbon remains in the soil today than in all of the atmosphere, plants, and animals on Earth combined. But we're at risk of releasing much of the rest. If at this point you're a little overwhelmed, that's understandable. Scientists have been worried about this for quite some time. So, you might be relieved to hear there's an answer right under our feet. I'm Mike DiGirolamo, and this is Problem Solved from Mongabay. Make sure to check out our additional videos and more coming like this on our YouTube channel by clicking subscribe. So, soil is central to solving the climate crisis, but before we address solutions, let's talk about how soil works.
Soil acts as a natural carbon sink, meaning it locks carbon below ground, sometimes for millions of years. In fact, there's still 2,500 billion tons of carbon down there. Along with vegetation, this is roughly 2.7 times the carbon now in the atmosphere. Earth's many biomes and ecosystems store varying amounts of carbon depending on climate, topography, living beings, and rocks and minerals. Add time on a geological scale, and you have all the ingredients to make new soil. To get lots of carbon into the soil, you need plants. They act as carbon straws, absorbing atmospheric CO2 and transforming it into wood, roots, and leaves. When plants die, they decompose and microbes break them down into simpler carbon compounds. Some of this carbon is respired back into the atmosphere, some gets digested by microorganisms, and some binds to the soil, where it can remain for centuries if left undisturbed. And voila! This is why soil is called a carbon sink.
The Earth's most carbon-rich soils occur in two different places, but for very different reasons. Tropical soils store immense amounts of carbon because they've never been frozen and have had the longest weathering period, breaking down parent material to form foundation soils. Tropical clay soils, due to the large surface area of the clay to which molecules can bond, are also able to store carbon undisturbed for millions of years. By contrast, subarctic permafrost way up north, which went through the Pleistocene era glaciation period, also known as the Ice Age, contains lots of non-decomposed plant and animal matter frozen below ground, trapping many tons of carbon for hundreds of thousands of years. Then came humans. Our modern industrial agricultural practices and rampant deforestation have greatly disturbed and degraded soil carbon storage capacity worldwide.
In the oil fields of all America, there is a man-made tree that grows. From its roots, thousands of feet in the earth, the oil well rig brings forth the harvest of precious sap. The trees you fell and the logs you drive make pulp for paper to blueprint the dreams. The way we do it in America takes a lot of different people working together in a lot of different places.
That, along with human-induced climate change, has released 50 to 70% of the carbon previously held in the Earth's soil. We've also put the remaining large subarctic and tropical carbon reservoirs at risk of more disruption. For example, if the Earth warms 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, giant quantities of tropical forests would begin to lose more carbon than they store, and some of them have already done this. And the permafrost could potentially release 92 billion tons of CO2 between now and 2100. So, how do we solve this? Easier said than done, but we simply must get it done. Let's break it down, starting with reforestation. So when you hear reforestation, you might think of planting a tree in an empty landscape. Plant enough trees and theoretically, you've reforested the land, right? Well, the problem is that one key ingredient that's missing: time. Simply planting a tree, while better than not planting one at all, isn't going to restore a soil's capacity to support a forest again. Time is needed for organic matter to decompose, for plant roots to weave below ground and give soil its structure, and for soils to get to the point where they are storing more carbon than they are losing. I mean, you need years, decades, and centuries to do this. So where, how, and for how long reforestation occurs matters quite a lot. Growing a tree plantation, for example, doesn't help much because fast-growing trees that are soon cut to make toilet paper or wood pellets for fuel don't store carbon for very long. In fact, it was recently revealed that nearly half of all proposed government commitments to global reforestation are made up of commercial monoculture tree plantations. That's a problem. Ultimately, forests are not individual trees or monocultures, but complex connected ecosystems built over time. What's needed are carefully recreated and monitored natural long-growing forests and, of course, people to fund these projects. Thankfully, there's an app for tracking this. Mongabay has a global directory of reforestation and tree planting projects that identifies projects by category and rates them using 36 expert-defined criteria, so you can see what each project aims to do. Now, planting trees and restoring forests and soils is a start, but what about conserving the soil we already have? Let's take a look at conservation. To conserve already existing carbon-rich soil, it's important to give high carbon storage areas, such as in the tropics, legal conservation status. And there are quite a few ways to approach this. Initiatives like the United Nations Red Plus is a voluntary program that provides economic and technical support to tropical forest countries and communities to help them conserve their existing forests. Also, there's conservation of soil carbon stocks, which is a central goal of Red Plus, and it is seeing some success in Brazil, where despite the government largely ignoring a regulated carbon offset trading market, the private sector has taken the lead. And then there is also creating state-protected carbon storage reserves in the tropics or in Canadian and US old-growth forests, and is a strategy that could yield really big results. Critically important, however, is recognizing and protecting indigenous land rights, as indigenous peoples do more to prevent deforestation than any other group on Earth. This can be a challenge in places like Brazil, where even though the country guarantees indigenous rights in its constitution, the government gave up forested lands for development to outsiders, equivalent to the size of the state of Indiana in 2020 alone. And of course, incentivizing nations to protect soils and forests also comes in the form of trade agreements that refuse to deal in export commodities produced on recently deforested lands. The European Union, for example, is blocking the world's biggest trade agreement with South America until Brazil agrees to better protect the Amazon. The same international forest conservation practices and pressures could be applied elsewhere. But what about all that soil carbon stored in the permafrost? How do we protect that? Well, that brings me to reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Unfortunately, in the case of melting permafrost, neither conserving the land nor planting native vegetation will stop escalating greenhouse gas releases. For the moment, drastically and quickly reducing humanity's global carbon emissions seems the sole best way of keeping this polar soil carbon in the ground. The methods needed to do this vary widely from region to region and sector to sector, but those reductions especially depend on steadily improving the sustainability and efficiency of our energy and food production systems. Still, the overwhelming majority of carbon emissions today come from fossil fuel combustion, and replacing fossil fuels with zero emission sources, be they wind, solar, hydrogen, geothermal, or likely a combination of many of these sources, is definitely needed to reduce global emissions. Last, but definitely not least, is agriculture. We could make an entire video series dedicated just to explaining agricultural changes needed now, but since I have only 15 minutes to do this, I'm going to keep it as brief as I can. Agriculture and land use are the second biggest emitter of greenhouse gas emissions globally. Remember when I talked about soil being a carbon sink? Well, it's the current industrial agricultural practices that are disrupting that, causing our vast global soil carbon sink to weaken every single day. For example, until very recently, the Amazon rainforest was a carbon sink, but it is now a carbon emitter, ejecting the same amount of CO2 as the annual emissions of Japan. That's largely due to Amazon deforestation in Brazil to make way for gigantic soy plantations and cattle pastures, which drastically reduce soil carbon storage ability. But Brazil is not the only country clearing rainforest to produce monoculture commodities for export. Other nations such as Indonesia, which is the world's largest producer of palm oil, have given much of their primary forest up to unsustainable agribusiness practices. And yes, the United States has 75% of the Midwest covered in similarly unsustainable monoculture crops like corn, which also greatly reduce soil carbon storage. So changing and replacing these agricultural and land use practices worldwide could really protect soils and greatly enhance carbon storage ability. According to experts, industrial agribusiness needs a complete overhaul, moving away from synthetic fertilizers, which wreck the nitrogen and phosphorus balance, reduce the use of pesticides, which ravage the soil biodiversity, and implementing no-till or low-till sustainable practices that keep soils healthy for the long haul. Rather than just planting one singular crop row by row, it's increasingly becoming more important to plant many kinds of crops together. And agroforestry may be a term you've heard of, but if you're new to the concept, it works like this. It relies on the planting of perennials, plants that live longer than 2 years, alongside annual monoculture crops to help bring more carbon and nutrients back into the soil to reduce erosion and cut the need for synthetic fertilizers and pesticides. And it can enhance the long-term financial viability of farms by providing a more diverse set of crops to sell. One current crop being touted as a solution in the US Midwest, for example, is the planting of hazelnuts. Nutella, anyone? So, why doesn't everyone do this, you might ask? Well, some hesitancy is due to financial considerations or cultural norms and the perceived risk to a farm's income. And it can be hard to change something that's been done for hundreds or thousands of years. But modern industrial agribusiness isn't even 100 years old, so some of the most difficult hurdles are the product of policy. Recognizing a farmer's land rights and the rights of indigenous communities can give the individual more autonomy over the land and therefore more ability to protect it. But in some countries like Vietnam, trees belong to the state, which can disincentivize farmers from planting them on their land. Brazil guarantees land rights to indigenous communities in its constitution, but doesn't seem to honor them in reality. And US agricultural policies tend to support the agribusiness status quo, not innovation or traditional knowledge. So, big policy shifts are needed to overcome these roadblocks, including recognizing land rights, supporting farmers and indigenous communities, and giving them the resources and the civic and legal support and protection they need. Whew, that's enough problems and solutions for one day, but I want to leave this on a positive note. The wheels of change are already turning with members of the IUCN World Conservation Congress approving a motion on September 10th, 2021 that calls to protect 80% of the Amazon by 2025. 61 governments and government agencies and 600 NGOs and indigenous peoples organizations voted in favor of the measure. Nice. Still, we have much to learn, and certainly a well-funded worldwide soil study program is urgently needed. Understanding soil biodiversity properties, capabilities, and timescales, and how we're altering them, could really help heal our strained relationship with the Earth, and be a pivotal step toward harnessing soil's carbon storage power to limit climate change. I think it's clear that restoring Earth's carbon balance requires a menu of solutions at many scales, but soil is at the center of them all. If you enjoyed Problem Solved and you want to see more content like this, subscribe to Mongabay on YouTube and find us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and LinkedIn, where our handle is @Mongabay. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.